if I have fixed this elastic fabric onto a circular frame, it's because today I want to show you one of the most surprising theorems in mathematics. Let's get straight to the point. If I were to rotate the frame, the points on the fabric would move around the center, which would remain the only point that doesn't change its position. But if I now deform the fabric slightly, pulling it to one side, even the center would move. However, and this is the heart of today's video, according to Brouwer's fixed point theorem, there will still be another point somewhere, I don't know exactly where, but it's there, that stays perfectly fixed on the same position it started from. Skeptical? Let me try to convince you by coloring the fabric. Here is the initial coloring, let's keep it as our reference. After the first rotation, you can see that the area around the center, the fixed point, keeps the same colors as before. Now let's deform the fabric and shift the center. There. With a bit of patience, you can compare this image with the original one and spot a region where the colors haven't changed. The fixed point lies somewhere in that area. We can make the deformations more complicated, but there will always be at least one fixed point. We can even overlap parts of the fabric, it still works. The only two things we cannot do are go beyond the boundary of the circular frame or cut or tear the elastic fabric. To prove Brouwer's fixed point theorem rigorously, mathematicians usually rely on topological spaces, continuous maps, and the fundamental group. But today, we'll see a proof that is accessible even to students in their first years of high school. Ready? Let's begin! Let's try to formalize the problem from a mathematical point of view. We can represent both the original and the deformed fabric as disks in the plane, including their boundaries. Take a point P on the initial disk. After the deformation, it ends up at a point F on the second disk. So we have a way to associate to each point of the first disk D a point on the second disk. In mathematics, such an association is called a function. The function F takes as input a point P from the first disk and assigns to it a point F, depending on P, in the second disk. The condition that the deformation never comes out of the circular frame ensures that F always remains within the disk. This function has one key property that will play a central role in the proof. It is continuous. We don't need the formal definition of continuity, it's enough to know that if two points on the initial disk are close to each other, then their images will also be close after the deformation. This property is guaranteed by the elasticity of the fabric. No matter how much we stretch it, if we take two points that are sufficiently close, we can make sure that their positions after deformation remain as close as we like. We would lose this property if we allow the cuts or tears. Two points that started close together could end up separated by a non-reducible distance, the gap of the tear. We are now ready to formalize the problem. We have a continuous function from the disk to itself, and we want to show that there exists at least one point that maps to itself, a point for which FP coincides with P. we'll proceed by contradiction. Proofs by contradiction are elegant and powerful. They show that something must be true by proving that its negation would lead to a contradiction. In our case, we'll assume that the function f has no fixed points, and we'll use this assumption, called contradictory hypothesis, to reach a logical impossibility. From this, we conclude that the assumption was false, and therefore, f must have at least one fixed point. One of the fascinating things about this kind of proof is that it's non-constructive. In the end, we'll know that a fixed point exists, but we'll have no idea where it is. Wonderful, isn't it? Let's see the proof. As anticipated, let's assume, for contradiction, that there exists a continuous function f from the disk to itself with no fixed points. For every p in the disk, fp is different from p. Now take a third copy of the disk and plot on it both p and fp. Since they are distinct, we can draw the ray that starts from f and passes through p. Thanks to the convexity of the disk, this ray will meet the boundary of the disk at a point q, which depends on p. The function that associates each p with the corresponding q has three important properties. It takes a point from the disk D and sends it to a point on the boundary of another disk, that is, on a circumference S. It is continuous. If we move p slightly, q moves slightly as well. I have reported the analytical expression for those who want to be more formal. And finally, it doesn't move the points on the boundary of the original disk. If p lies on the edge, the ray from f through p meets the final circle exactly at p. So q and p coincide. Here I summarize the three properties just seen. They will allow us to reach a contradiction. To do that, we need to partition the disk. Don't worry, nothing that will harm your laptop. We are simply dividing the starting disk into a union of concentric circles that we'll call loops. Let P be the center of the disk, and Q the point on S associated with it by the function we have built. By continuity, points sufficiently close to P are mapped to points arbitrarily close to Q in the circumference. In particular, the smaller loops around P will be squeezed into tiny loops around Q. Let me show you what happens. These rubber bands represent the concentric loops we have drawn on the disk. We know that the smallest one ends up around Q, here on the boundary. As we take larger loops, the corresponding curves can stretch, move, even overlap. But this will never happen. The band can never wind completely around the circle. Why? Because if we can move continuously from the largest loop of the original disk all the way to the center P, then their images on the circle S must also move continuously, contracting all the way down to Q. But if one of those curves were to wind entirely around the circle, we could no longer shrink it back to Q without cutting it or going outside the boundary, and that by continuity is impossible. In short, none of these curves can ever make a full turn around the final circle. But wait, the points on the edge remain fixed. The function doesn't move them. So the largest circle is mapped point by point onto the final circle, wrapping around it. Yet we've just shown that by continuity such a thing cannot happen. And there is the contradiction. It arises precisely from assuming that f had no fixed points. Therefore, every continuous function from the disk to itself must have at least one fixed point. Brouwer's Fixed Point Theorem doesn't apply only to disks. It also holds for squares or for any shape that can be put in one-to-one correspondence through continuous function in both directions with the disk. Brouwer's theorem is just one among many fixed point theorems. For example, we have Kellogg's theorem, which under certain additional conditions guarantees the uniqueness of the fixed point, Schauder's theorem, which applies to more general, even infinite dimensional spaces, and the Banach-Cacioppoli theorem, which by adding a bit of structure provides a simple algorithm to find the fixed point's position. So, there are plenty more results to explore, and time is on your side. I hope you enjoyed the video. Leave me a like or a comment, and in the meantime, don't panic.